on transgressive Mississippian carbonates. Nah, it's all good, buddy.
We do.
The check is in the mail. Let's put it that way.
Morning.
Good.
How are you?
Good.
Good. How's this work?
So basically.
Okay.
Advance it. Okay. Go to the next slide. If you have to go back, hit this button.
Okay.
And you got the
pointer.
The pointer.
Get this.
All right.
Thank you.
No problem.
Should I go?
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, Adam.
I mean, I don't know if it's a bit noisy, but yeah, you can just get started, whatever.
I'll let him sit down, please.
I think so.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead, John.
Good morning. Yeah, this morning I'm going to talk about facies in the Mississippian Frobisher beds. And before I start, I'd like to thank a few people. I'd like to thank Melinda Yurkowski and her group at the lab in Regina for all their help in pulling the core and getting it to Calgary and everything. I'd like to thank Robert Norris and the Stratera group for their use of their core logging program. I'd like to thank the group here that did all the organizing. These guys do all the groundwork, and we get all the glory. So they don't get much appreciation, but they do a good job here.
Thanks, John.
Yeah, you're welcome. And then I'd like to thank Google Earth as well, because they promoted me to the professional Google Earth program these days. So I'm going to use a few of their diagrams here. So the title says that these are transgressive carbonates, and that usually brings heresy to the group that works in carbonates. They like ramp models, and that's not what I think is happening here. Oops. So this is modern calcareous algae, blue-green algae, and these guys were contributing a lot of the sediment in the Mississippian carbonates. This is penicillus. Have halomita penicillus. They're photosynthetic. When they die, they disintegrate into platelets, and they contribute a lot to the sediments here. These guys are on the exam because you're going to see them as reservoir, believe it or not. So this is a, I don't know if everybody can see this, but this is my facies model. I think that the Frobisher cycles are in the range of about a township in an area. This is a model from Qatar Peninsula here. And I think what's happening is we have a gray area, which is inner tidal flat. That's where the algae are growing in a shallow tidal to subtidal interval. And then we have the tides are actually moving these the detritus from the tidal flat out into open ocean. I call them low tide drainage channels. And then we have in the deeper water where we have agitation, we have oolite shoals here. So the trick is to distinguish which is the best reservoir. If you were in the Michigan or Illinois basin, you'd be going for the oolite shoals. They're prolific producers in Mississippi and in the Michigan and Illinois basins. In the Williston Basin and the Frobisher here, these are the best traps. So we got to kind of analyze why they don't produce, and you know, can we take advantage of that knowledge? So the next, all these are actually core photos taken by my petrographic microscope of core, rather than show you thin sections and show you ideal. I dialyzed the facies. I'm going to show you the reality of what you're going to see in the core boxes. This one here is there's a lot of clastic input by the dust blowing off a desert, so that's you're pretty well on land in that facies. This is a tidal flat here. You can see bird's eye fenestral texture, and there's an oncolite in there. So, and this tends to be a decent reservoir because of exposure and development of buggy porosity right away. And we get into facies where we start to see calcareous algae, waxstones, these penicillus type of facies are contributing quite a bit to the rock here. And then as we get deeper, you start to see the influence of the tides more. You're developing oolites and oncolites. And then finally here's a oolite grainstone. These things tend to be cemented up pretty badly with anhydrite, and when you look at them, they actually look like lime mudstones if you don't have your hand lens with you. And then at the bottom of these oolite channels, we see erosional surfaces. So there's some kind of, that's a transgressive package. This is part of the transgressive model rather than a ramp model for these sediments here. So in terms of reservoir quality, I want to be tidal flats or the tidal drainage channels, and I want to avoid the oolites. And I'll try to, with the core I have on display here, I'm going to show you that these things aren't basin-wide, that we're only dealing with transgressions that are townships in an aerial extent there. So that's a tough sell. There's a lot of models that say we're a ramp model. We get deeper as we go into North Dakota and Montana. And you go look at those rocks, they're the same depths as the ones in Saskatchewan. So here's the base of the channel. You can see erosion, you can see rip-up class. This is the oolite package. And it's pretty easy to distinguish where the oolites are because they're cemented. This is not where you want to be. Dan Colrus came by the core yesterday and said maybe those things are actually acting as a trap, as a aquitard in the package here. You can see on my core descriptions that we go grainstone, and then quite often there's the sequence will be truncated. There's actually erosion on the top of some of these cycles. So these are three of the four cores that I have on display here, and what I did was I tried to lay them out in this photo based on the distribution of facies rather than of building a stratigraphic cross section here. So these cores are sitting right above the Kisby sand. This is the basal package of Frobisher. They're near the unconformity, and this is a duster. These two on the right here are actually producers, past producers. There's the base of the oolite package there. It grades up into the tidal flat facies up here, the carbonate factory, and the porosity is much better at the top here. This one you can see the oolite package, the cemented oolites here, and underneath is the carbonate factory again. And this one here is just stacked oolites. There's 20 meters of stacked oolites in this package here, and doesn't look very good in core. The logs are kind of useless on these things. I'll show you what's happening, but the logs are showing a buggy porosity, that it's ineffective. They're not connected to anything in these oolites. There's the logs. You probably can't see them from where you're sitting, but come on by the core and check it out here. But you can see these cycles shallowing upwards, high energy. And then when you're in the tidal flats, you tend to have much better porosity, and the staining is better. So this idea of staying away from the high energy oolite shoal is seems to work here. There's a cross section. These two wells are in the same pool. This is Froud. This is Stoughton, and this is East Wilmar. So we're covering probably 30 miles between these wells here. And the only reason I hung them on here was to show you that how far we are above the Kisby marker here. So this is the thickest package, but we're really close to the subcrop edge, and this is the Triassic Watrous here above it here. So this, the difference in thickness is just the distance away from the subcrown. So these are the basal cycles of the Mississippian. And you can see from the logs, I showed you the core, you can see the logs are not going to help you with the facies. You got to pull the core boxes out and check them out there. That's a, so these aren't like clastics. You can't use and say, I'm in a sandstone, I'm in a siltstone. These ones, you can't even figure out if you're in a oolite shoal or whatever, where you're. Okay, these are oolites and oncolites in here. And you'll notice that most of the nuclei of these coated grains are actually the calcareous algae. So we sourced the nuclei from these things from the tidal flat portion of our model there. What you'll notice is that this is anhydrite. Isopachus rim anhydrite in filling the pores here. So the first thing you say is, well, that happened within the water table because we don't have a dripstone kind of thing. We're in a fluid to precipitate this anhydrite. So that's significant because when I show you the next photo here, this is a trench in the east coast of Qatar, modern Carbonates. There's the water table. This is only less than a meter here. And you can see where the gypsum crystals are growing. So the all this problem we have with anhydrite is based with where the water table is. So there's the evidence in the Mississippian, and there's the modern one. You can see the analog is similar here. So why is our oolite grainstone being cemented worse than the tidal flat package? It may be a function that if you're above the water table, you're going to preserve porosity better. Because if you're drilling a horizontal well in these things, you're drilling along fine, and then all of a sudden you hit a wall of anhydrite, and you wonder what the heck happened. You know. Now this is where I break. I like looking at rocks, and then all of a sudden there's something shiny that takes my interest. So this is where I start talking about collisions. And this poor guy is going to have a hard time explaining it to the insurance company because it's a single-lane highway and there's nobody out there. But I like the geological background. That's why I chose that one. This is a satellite image of the Caribbean platform. And this is Cuba, and we're looking towards Florida up here. And you can see, Mid-Atlantic Ridge comes down through here. You can see that there's a clasting input. There's actually some volcanic activity within the Caribbean here. U.S. Virgin Islands have volcanics there. And what you notice is you can see the oolite shoals and so on. But if we looked at this in the millions of years in the future, we would say the deep water is in the Caribbean based on this platform being uplifted. And I think that's what happens in Mississippian time. We have this idea of drainage to the south, but we don't think of these major plates being moved and creating this image that we're getting. We deepen towards something which is actually just a tectonic event. So this is part of the Google Earth professional one here. If you ever get on there, your mornings go by very quickly. Last year I showed the Red River. This is the Ordovician Red River Yeoman package, and this is Manitoba, Saskatchewan border. This is the U.S. border. This thing thickens towards the east, whereas the Williston Basin, even in Ordovician time, was supposed to drain to the south. So Jameson and Strominger had this paper. They suggest that African plate running into the Eurasian plate crashing into the Asian plate here creates a rotation of the Arabian plate and creates the Persian Gulf. And I think that's maybe what was happening within the Ordovician here. This is part of the heresy, part of the story here. Because when you see the there's the same map in on this package here, and this is the yeoman. Here's the herald. There's an unconformity on top of the yeoman here. We have everything is back to normal in the herald. We have drainage to the south again. Arden made the maps for me when we were putting the story together, and what I did was I put all of the Mississippi informations on this poster here. We start at the base here. This is the Source Valley lodgepole package. What I notice is a linear feature through here, and these beds are displaced by in the order of 20 kilometers. This is a early Mississippian, probably associated with the antler orogeny. So that's something I didn't know was happening until we made this map here. And come by the core display, and you can see the bigger version of it. And then here's the Elida beds, Frobisher that we're dealing with, and then there's the Mydale beds, and things are pretty stable compared to the end of Source Valley time there. So that's pretty cool. Who would have thunk that anything happened tectonically within Saskatchewan? You know, this is supposed to be a stable place. You know, all the illusions are gone. And that was an eye opener, because I think that's gonna when you're exploring in the deeper part of the Source Valley Lodgepole, you're gonna suddenly realize that things can be displaced in here. So this is what the Precambrian guys, how they see the world. There's the suture between the Superior Province and the Churchill Province, and that this is where all that activity is going along, right along the Saskatchewan Manitoba border there. This is John Lurie's idea of what was happening in the Precambrian time, where he saw a Sask craton, and here's a Superior crashing into it. So every time we have a orogeny, here's a Grenville package. It wants to move all this stuff westward, and then we have the Arctic collisions, and then finally the activity in Western Canada here. And I think what we're doing is every time we have some tectonics, we reactivate some of these old sutures, and the sediments are showing us a response from that. There's a map of, there's the Williston Basin, there's the center of the universe. And then here's the Appalachian packages, here's the Michigan and Illinois basins. Those things had a lot better circulation than Williston Basin. And then it really shows you the heart of this thing. The Precambrian packages have been under collision. We've had collisions, you know, in the Grenville package. We've had the Laurentian, or the Rocky Mountains forming here. There's a satellite image of what happened. There's the Williston Basin up here. There's the Appalachians. They had the Grenville Province. They had the Taconic and Acadian orogenies, and everything wanted to go that way. And then we reactivate these things through time. You can see how young the Rockies look compared to the Appalachians. You know, you can see and then the Precambrian continents did the same thing. You know. And this is my last slide here. Denbury, these guys have on their website are showing that they're gonna build a CO2 pipeline from South Dakota, and build one up to Cedar Creek Anticline, which is one of these major features that has stacked reservoirs. They have Red River, Ore Division, Red River, Mississippi. They have Bakken. They have Mississippian production, and the numbers are on here of what the price is, and how much gas they're gonna get the gas, and how much they're gonna get out of it. So this is the Cedar Creek anticline. This is Montana here. These guys are gonna build a pipeline and flood these pools on the way up there. So this is something that we have to think about in Canada, doing the same thing, because the discovery reserves are going down, but we've left a lot in the ground still. And where can we get CO2 economically to make these things work? You know? And there's the Nesson anticline, and there's the subcrop pools in Saskatchewan, all the trends in Saskatchewan. So the ramp model should be ignored. You should probably use a transgressive surface or transgressive package, and then think of these things only in terms of a township in aerial extent here. Probably forgot a few things, but come by the core and we'll check it out here. Cool rocks, and I think there's a thesis for a grad student if they want to study the cementation of those oolites. I think that's a pretty cool topic. Huh? So if there's any questions, I'll try to help you that way. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, I didn't say that. Good. Thanks, man.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, John. Yeah, thanks.